goodness and love. Thank you for your mercy, Lord. Thank you for being there with us when it seems the bleakest time, because we know that you've been there, you've done that, and you became victorious, Lord, and that you give us the hope to guide us and direct us by your word and your spirit, Lord, that you'll just bring us through whatever we're going through, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We pray today you'll just bless this body, Lord. Fill us with your spirit, guide us, direct us. Open up our hearts to what you have to say for us, to us, Lord, and help us to take that message to the people that need it so badly out there, Lord. We pray today you'll just guide Dave as he leads us in song and worship and announcements and everything, Lord. We're so glad that they're back safely. And Nancy, and thank you for Karen and all the things she does as she plays so beautifully, Lord, and the ladies caring and sharing. Thank you for Tony and Rich and the councilmen, Lord. Bless them and strengthen them and use them, Lord. Thank you for Jen that she brings all the technology to us, Lord. Guides us and helps us, Lord. Thank you for the pastor, Lord. Bless him and guide him. Anoint him, Lord. Speak to our hearts. Break up our fallow ground and help us to plant a good seed that produces good fruit, Lord, and pull up any weeds or thorns that may be there and allow us to have your way in our lives, that you will be number one, not us, Lord. We thank you for everybody else as a part of this ministry. Thank you for everybody's online watching today. Whether they're sick or healthy, Lord, pray you'll touch them, Lord. Speak to their hearts as you do us, Lord. Guide us and direct us. And may we give you the glory, the honor, and the praise in everything we do. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if you picked up the bulletin, please get one today. New Year's Day edition. Scripture reading today is Psalm 31, 23, and 24. I love the Lord, all you his godly ones. The Lord preserves the faithful and fully recompenses the faithful doer. Be strong and let your heart take courage, all you who hope in the Lord. Now Dave's back. He's going to lead us in worship, the announcements and everything. Sing to the Lord a praise song.
Good morning. Let's stand, shall we? Great is thy faithfulness.
Thank you.
was neat, the technology, we were able to, you know, connect on Zoom sometimes and also watch the YouTube video and things like that. We could spot who was here and who wasn't. I don't see such and such. Oh, there they were, you know. I'll tell you, Tony went up in hospital a week and a half ago or something like that. So on Saturday, he said, we need to call Karen and find out how Tony's. And Tony picked up the phone. I said, whoa, you're supposed to be in the hospital. And the next day, he was here in the service, who really something. And yesterday, he came up from the hospital again. So we said, we better get up to church early. We're going to have to do communion and set things up. And we pull in, and Tony's car is there. So Nancy says, Karen must be driving Tony's car today. No, he was here. So thank the Lord for Tony. Pray for Tony. He had fluids around his lungs. That's what his issues were. But anyway, pray for him. So we thank everybody else that jumped in. Rich for, you know, doing music while we were away. We had a neat choir with a lot of variations in music and things like that that we were really good, really happy to see and all that. But it's good to be back. What you didn't need to do is blow a whole bunch of cold down to Florida, though. Before we came back, we had some 27-degree mornings where we covered the bushes up the house that we were staying in and things like that. But anyway, it was a bunch colder up here, I know. But anyway, we had a good time down there and a good time of fellowship. We have Christian friends down there. A lot of my family, six of my brothers and sisters, when we're down there, all have either moved there or winter in Florida and things like that. We had a good time together. We celebrated my sister's 83rd birthday down there too, so that was a good time. Anyway, we're back and ready to get things in gear and stuff. So a few announcements. The December, January, February daily bread is back on the table. Also, there's a whole table full of Christmas cards over here on my left, your right. So on your way out, take the long road around there and grab any Christmas cards that might be for you. We thank all the cards that came to our place. We decided we weren't going to forward our mail down there. That has been a catastrophe. Several times we tried to do that. So we just collected the mail up here, and our daughter-in-law will go in and see if there was anything that we needed. But anyway, an awful lot of cards from our church family went up at our home address. And we decided we're not going to open that first card until we can be together. And you slide them open, and you read them, and then I hand them to me, and I'll read them, and we'll, you know, make notes or anything. So that's we did a couple days after we got, but it was really neat. Thank you so much for the cards and everybody missing us. And we've been doing that the rental thing in Florida for 11 or 12 years. And the people that we've rented from the last several years, they said, we're coming back for the whole winter. So you'll have to find another place. So Nancy said, well, good, maybe we'll just Berlin, or actually. Anyway, for next Christmas. But anyway, we do miss the season and everything else. It's neat to pass that load off onto others and things, and we appreciate that. And you are our family, so we're not sure what the year holds anyway. Also on the back table, there are some letters to the church from the Campbells on the back. And then we also heard, and I just gave it to Caroline, a letter from the Schwartzes. And it might just be a card, I'm not sure. Is there any
letter?
Okay.
Yes.
They've been kind of hard to get the information from. But anyway, we did get a note from them this morning, too. And let me just mention Caroline, and there's some others that she's asked. We're going to form an official missions committee to keep on top and keep connected with the missionaries that we support. And anyway, and Caroline did that before she moved back into the area. And so anyway, she's working for hitting that up. We're going to have a meeting in a couple of weeks to kind of so that everybody is all on the same path, who our missionaries are, how to contact them, and anything that's unique about the missionaries that we Abbey Bible Church support. So that's a neat addition that's happening. Okay, I think those are anything else that we should mention? Charlie had his arm fixed, so be careful when you shake his hand this morning. He's still recovering from that. Okay.
Stay right there.
First Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 12 says, "But we request of you, brethren, that you appreciate those who diligently labor among you and have charge over you in the Lord and give you instructions, and that you esteem them very highly in love because of their work." Well, we appreciate our leaders here. And over Christmas, Tony got a card, Rich got a card, I got a card, and we absolutely esteem Dave with love. And but we appreciate how you diligently labor among us. So we just want to say as a congregation, thank you very much for all that you do.
We did get I got a card from the ladies. So thank you, ladies.
Oh, well, don't you know that.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you for laughing at that, Nancy. Well, good morning. A few updates on the prayer request. We're going into prayer time now. Jen McCormick and Faye both tested positive for COVID. So if you haven't heard that yet, that's why they're not here this morning. Keep them in your prayers because, well, Faye said she's more bored than sick. So she's been at home alone for last week. I can see that Jen McCormick, she was on Zoom this morning. She's getting a little frustrated, but she's still sick. She's getting more frustrated from the fact that she can't do anything, the weakness and things that come with that. So and those who just got over it know what the frustrations can cause. So keep Jen in your prayers because she's not with us this morning. But continue to pray for Faye as well, that they can both beat this quickly and get back to their lives. Jen Pinto, when's your grandma's funeral?
On Saturday.
Okay, so the same day you come, okay.
The day after. I leave the day after.
You're leaving Sunday?
Yeah.
Okay. But you're leaving Saturday. So sure, you got to leave Saturday now. Right, but this week, Jen Pinto, her grandmother's funeral is on Saturday, for those who remember her grandmother passed. So just keep the whole family in your prayers throughout this week as they leave this week. And then remember that just because everyone else goes back to their normal lives, there's people like her uncle and her dad whose lives will never be the same after losing their mother. So keep them in your prayers. Just continue to remember that. And then on Sunday, not Saturday, on Sunday, that's the day after Saturday, for those who have followed along, Jen is going to Colorado again. So she's going to be flying out there. So, two parts. One, pray for Jen as she travels. And she won't be here next week. So, Jen's asked several times to make this announcement, and now it's a last case scenario urgency announcement. But if anybody's interested in helping with the computer in the back, Jen would love to teach you this morning so you'll be ready next week. No, she's mentioned before that if anyone's ever interested in learning more about how to do the slides and doing the computer, so you can be a fill-in for when, in case Jen wants to go to Florida for 10 weeks, someone can feel, hey, Rich, you can just jump back there and just go back and forth, So pray for Jen. She won't be here next week, but that was also an announcement for anyone who wants to, looking for an opportunity to serve and contribute. Adriana, where's she at? Pray for Adriana's knee. She's had knee issues longer than I've known her. I have bad knees. You're like 23, 24, 25, how old are you? 27, whatever. Pray for Adriana's knee. No, but she said that one of her New Year's resolutions is to actually go get physical therapy this year. Probably something she shouldn't have been putting off, and has been for years. So keep Adriana's knee in your prayers. And then Alan. So many of you got a chance to see Alan last week when he was here. But Alan, has lung cancer and. Last week he said he hasn't eaten several days, and the only reason he eats, he says, because Karen forced him to. He's weak, and he's frustrated, and he's discouraged, and now he just found out that he also has tongue cancer. So I don't know if it's spreading or if it's just two separate instances, but they wanted him to stay in the hospital for 8 to 10 days over the next week or so. Karen's guessing it's probably treatment they want to do. Whether Alan's going to submit and succumb to the treatment, or continue to do his own thing, we don't know. Just keep Alan in your prayers, because, not only the discouragement, the frustration, the pain, but there's fear that comes along with it as well. So keep Alan in your prayers. Those are ones I got from Sunday school. Just a few updates. he's at the top of our list. I just want to mention this because, praise God, Kevin's dad, we've been praying for him for like, it's like 2 weeks we've been praying for him. No, we've been praying for him for a few months now, but it seems like only a few weeks. But God, he's cancer-free. He rang, it's been called cancer-free. They rang the bell. Did it use the word remission?
No, it's just his treatment's over.
Just his treatment's over, all right? He rang the bell, his treatment's over. So keep Kevin's dad, continue to pray for him, and continue to pray that he gets healthier, stronger, that he continues this whole situation, can bring God glory. Because I know several people who I've just mentioned this to, and they're already praising God for how God answers prayers. And so we've seen God answer so many prayers in this church, so continue to pray for Ed and watch how God heals. You mentioned Charlie. Well, Charlie, how you doing?
Good.
All right. Can you go like this? Not yet?
Yeah.
All right, good start. Oh, wait a second. Doctor, it hurts like you look like this. I'm not like this, all right. So continue to keep Charlie in your prayers. And we mentioned Tony, but pray for Karen. I know Tony's a rock, and which is I mentioned in Sunday school, one of the great things about having one of our leaders that stable, and so it's awesome that God has used Tony to preserve Albion for decades and decades. But I can't imagine the stress that's been on Karen during those decades and decades. And now Tony, with whether it's congestive heart failure or just fluid around a lung, whatever's going on there, he has shortness of breath. And look, I love the idea that there's something really neat here, because in the scriptures, when we see the word spirit in Greek, it's the same word as breath, pneuma. That's why we see pneumonia is breath and pneuma, and it's the same word spirit. So I've been praying that God strengthens Tony's breath as well, and you hear me pray almost every Sunday that God strengthens his spirit within us. So continue to pray for Tony, but he's in God's hands. Whether it's strong breath, short breath, long breath, weak breath, he's in God's hands. Pray for Karen as she worries for Tony, as she stresses over Tony's breath. So keep good Karen and Tony in your prayers, that whole household. Anything else we need to be praying for? I got pens here, so I'm ready to write it down. Anything? Carly?
My sister Laura has COVID. She lives in Tennessee. And my sister walked in some Florida. She's just waiting for getting her back surgery. And my friend Kathy, who just recently relocated from Florida to Pennsylvania, her sister Jenny, who she's living with, has a brain tumor cancer that she's being treated for. But most recently, she had a terrible fall and she broke several ribs. And she also has a fluid on the brain. Mm-hmm.
Where is she staying exactly? Do you know?
Jane lives in Florida.
Where are your friends? Where's Kathy staying?
Kathy lives in Moscow, Pennsylvania.
Okay. Anything else?
My sister Beth texted us this morning and said she turned positive for COVID. Mm-hmm. And her cousin, Freddie, he was sick like last week or whatever. So they had to isolate him in the bedroom and take his meals to him. And now Beth is sick and they've isolated my mom because she's in her little efficiency apartment or whatever. And even though she doesn't have it, she's very lonely now because all you do is bring the meals to her, so she doesn't catch it next. But if you had the COVID, we'd be safe. So just praying, the Lord will help them go on and everything. But again, the praise, thank you for everybody who provided all the food on our Christmas luncheon or whatever. And Josh brought it over to us, and it was more than enough. And once in a while, we did get a taste buds back, but it was really great and thoughtful.
I love that. It was such great food that brought over. I couldn't taste it that COVID, but it was great. You brought it.
Yeah.
I should just pour it in gula. Hi.
Yes, my friend, she babysits a little boy named, she said her last name is Wilson, and his mother passed away yesterday in a car accident.
How old is he?
He's five. His mother is probably in her 30s.
Wow.
Yeah, so happy yesterday. So just keep the faith.
are you feeling?
Well, I'm achy a little because I took a fall when I went to see Disney on Ice with the kids and I missed the step and was bent up like a pretzel. So this side, which I have problems with, the knee and the foot are aching again, but it'll get better this time. You get older like that, everything, you take a little step when it hurts.
Kathleen asked us to pray for her granddaughter, Crystal. Crystal with the cake. But her granddaughter had already had a kidney transplant years ago, Kathleen, and she needs another one. So I don't know how old Crystal is, but Kathleen asked us multiple times, and she texted me this morning to make sure that we will be praying for her. So make sure you keep Crystal, Kathleen's granddaughter, in your prayers. Anyone else?
General Cormack asked that we please lift her friend Derek up. He has cancer.
Derek?
Derek.
Oh. Well, Margie also wanted us to keep her daughter-in-law's mother, Donna, Casey's mother, Donna, in our prayers. You can ask Margie specifics or maybe something about it. Keep Donna in your prayers as well. Jim, you want to
end? Praise from the Martinez. They said, we praise God for improved relationship with your experience with their daughter. You can cherish it also.
Awesome. Praise God. Continue to pray for Mike in New Jersey. Even though they're not here, they're still part of the spot family. They're still part of the spot. They're watching. They watch every Sunday. So make sure you continue to lift them up. And keep Mike's friend, Debbie. She had a feeling of depression. Mike asked to pray for her as well as his granddaughter and his relationship with his daughter. So praise God. Continues to work. I just want to say real quick, we see here Tom and Janice at the top. Keep Janice in your prayers. Her blood pressure is rising and she's been falling. Whether it's she's been getting weaker and weaker, and it's been frustrating Tom, and it's been causing him to have physical challenges, having to pick her up, causing his sciatica, his back, just all the challenges. And she's still, every Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, she still has to go to dialysis, no matter how much pain she's in, because that's the only thing keeping her alive. So continue to pray for Tom and Janice. And at least once a week, they tell me how much they wish they could be here. They always blame the other one. Tom says Janice's fault, Janice says Tom's fault, so I assume they're both from the truth. But make sure you keep them in your prayer team if they can't be with us. And then also, we see Joey here, you guys can pray for Joey, but William Bowers. Billy texted me this week, so make sure you keep Billy in your prayer. I don't know what prompted that, what God laid on his heart, but it's kind of interesting that he falls right in line with the alphabetical order. He's on the top of our list, the same week I had heard from him in a couple months. So keep William Bowers in your prayers. Anything else? Anyone else? Let's just spend some time with the Lord in prayer right now. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can come into your presence this morning. Lord, we pray that right now that you prepare our hearts for worship, prepare our hearts, our minds for communion. And Lord, we thank you that we can come here and praise you, exalt you, and worship the true living God. And Lord, we thank you that we have the right to be called children of God. The love that you bestowed on us. Lord, we thank you for this love. Strengthen this love, that we can love one another and that others can see your love in us, and we can be extensions of your love no matter where we go. So right now, Lord, bless. Bless this body of believers that you brought together this morning, Lord. I thank you for each person here, each person online. Lord, whatever's going on in our lives, there's things that are causing distractions, but Lord, you brought us here this morning for a purpose. So take these distractions away. Take away our agenda, our thoughts, feelings, our preferences, Father, and instill into us your will. What you have in store for us, what you want us to learn, what you want us to do this morning. So conform our will to yours through our prayers. Lord, hear the prayers of our heart, the things that we wrote down on the list, the things that were said, the things that were unspoken and lie dormant in our hearts that we think might not be important enough to say. Father, you are praying on our behalf. Your Holy Spirit is praying for us. We thank you. We praise you. And we put our prayers and our anxieties, our worries, our concerns, our cares are at your feet. We thank you that we can enter into your presence. So prepare us for communion. Prepare us for worship. Ready our hearts and minds that you take glory, honor, and joy from us this morning. Allow us to bless the name of the Lord. We thank you. Lord, we thank you for the praying for him, someone let him know you're praying for him. Ask him for something you're praying for. Let everyone know that you're happy to see him in the house of the Lord this morning. But do it in 180 seconds. Go.
How are you?
So how's your day?
How you doing, Jen? Sorry about your grandma.
Thank you.
here we are, January 1st. And I love this idea. I love that we do communion. I say this almost every month. I love we can do it on the first Sunday of the month, but I love that January 1st, this first Sunday of the month, fell on the first day of the year. It's really neat because a new year causes us to do two things, I found. One, we look back and we take inventory over a year. This kid had a lot to look back on, man. He did some crazy things this year. But he was born. But no, we look back on our year and we take personal inventory. We take stock of where we're at and we start analyzing and evaluating things. But we also, we make resolutions or we make plans and we look to the future. And I think that is just so fitting for this. This. It's only right in front of me. I think it's so fitting because we do this in remembrance and we look back. But as often as we do this, we proclaim the Lord's death till he comes and we look forward. So it's a really neat thing that I think it's perfect for New Year's Day. I think this is perfect for the first, not only the first Sunday of the month, but I think it's perfect for the first Sunday of the year. That we not only do this in remembrance, remember what he's done as we look back, not only we take inventory, we take personal stock, we do evaluate. And that's what we're going to do. We're going to stop, and as men are distributing the elements, we'll take time to take personal inventory and let the Holy Spirit speak to you. If there's things in your life that are separating you from God, let him bring it to your attention. And we've said, you've heard him say this many times, that word confess, homologeos, is same word. Same word. God will lay it on your heart, the attitude you had, and you don't go, well, the reason I had that attitude was because that person, this, you don't know the Lord, you don't know what I felt like when he, no, we just say, yeah, I had the wrong attitude. And God said, yo, you lied in that situation. But, well, the reason I lied, I was trying to help, and you're not, it's good to, no, we just say, yeah, I lied. And my attitude, and same, whatever it is he lays on your heart, we don't try to make excuses for it, we don't try to justify it. We confess, and he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So I don't know what's going on in your life, but this is a beautiful thing. You could be in church every day this week, you could be serving and ministering, and there's still things in your life that you need to get right. Or it could be a while since you've been in church. Or it could be a while since you had communion. It could be, you might not really sure where you stand, but well, this is a great opportunity to get yourself right. So wherever you are, with your walk with God, this is a great opportunity not only to do this in remembrance, but also we proclaim the Lord's death and what he's did for us until he comes. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul says, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he gave it thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do as often as you do this in remembrance.'" In the same way, he took the cup at the supper, saying, "This cup is a new cup in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." The gentleman will come forward and ask God to bless this cup. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this table, that we get to enter into your presence, to commune with our King, our Creator, our God, our Lord, our Savior. Help us to never take these things for granted. Lord, right now, bless this bread and those who partake of it. Lord, we pray that your blessing upon it, as you draw us into your presence, as we commune with you, Father, hear the confessions of our heart. And Lord, cleanse us from all unrighteousness. As you draw us into your presence, allow us to bless your name through this process. And we just love you and praise you. my body. This piece of unleavened bread does not morph into the body of the Messiah. No, it was a symbol. It was a beautiful, perfect, perfect symbol that was taking place thousands of years before Jesus even said it. Because the Passover Seder, he took this bread, this unleavened bread, and in Jewish tradition, leaven is a symbol of sin. So he took a sinless bread from an echad, a unity container. Not the first or the third, but the middle, the center of the echad, the second of the triunity. And he took the center of the triunity, and he broke it, but he put one back, half back, so it remained a whole. And he took the other, and he wrapped it in white linen, and buried it away. And this is something Jewish people have been doing for thousands of, 1,500 years before Jesus, 2,000 years since Jesus. Many of them don't even know what they're doing, but we know. We see it perfectly. We see it perfectly. With that, he took this sinless bread, this bread that is striped and pierced. He pierced for our transgressions, and through his stripes we're healed. A sinless, striped, pierced, part of a unity, he took it out and wrapped it in white linen, buried it away, and on the third cup, he took it out. Sinless, perfect, striped, pierced, unity, buried, risen, on the third. And he said, "This is my body. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup after supper and blessed it. Just ask God to bless this cup. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we stand redeemed, that we can stand holy, blameless, and above reproach in a perfect God's eyes because of Jesus. We thank you for this redemption. We thank you for this salvation. We thank you for the blood that was shed. Lord, we thank you that we can do this in honor and remembrance. We thank you for this cup. So bless this cup. Bless those who partake of it. Lord, bless this time now. We thank you for it. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Passover Seder, there are four cups that the Jewish people would drink of. And, each cup is a promise that was made in Exodus chapter 6. I just looked it up. The first cup is the cup of deliverance. And it's Exodus 6:6. It says to the sons of Israel, "I am the Lord, and I will bring you out from the burden of the Egyptians." The second cup is the cup of sanctification. So I will deliver you from, I will deliver you from their bondage. I will rescue you from their bondage. The third cup, "I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and a great judgment." And then the fourth cup is, "Then I will take you up to be holy people. I will take you up to be my people." First cup, cup of deliverance, sanctification. The third cup is the cup of redemption. And Jesus said, this cup that I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and a mighty act of judgment. Jesus said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. As often as you drink this, do this. And then we have to now follow Cynthia. Three years and 3,000 miles, Paul returned to Antioch. That was his home church. If you remember that they had the Jerusalem Council about the year 49, and then when they left the Jerusalem Council, if you recall, two prophets, as they called them, two individuals were told to strengthen people through that message. So a man named Silas and Judas went up with Paul and Barnabas back to Antioch. And Judas and Silas shared about what the Jerusalem Council said about this in this letter and encouraged the people. And then Barnabas said, Paul wanted to go back out on a trip again. Barnabas said, hey, let's take Mark with us. And you remember that disagreement between Barnabas and Paul. And Barnabas went to Cyprus, and Paul took Silas and went back up to Galatia. And he traveled through Galatia, and then he Phrygia, and then they went into Macedonia because of the vision, and then all through Macedonia, and then went into Achaia, and then into Asia, and then all the way back to Jerusalem, probably dropped off Silas in Jerusalem, and then him and Timothy returned to Antioch after 3 years and 3,000 miles on the road, all week. And verse 23, he says, and having spent some time there, he left. He gets not even one verse at home. All week I've been thinking about this verse as it's been bouncing around in my mind for the last 6 weeks or so. A Willie Nelson song kept coming to my mind. You guys know what it is? On the road again, going places. Because he's right back. And I think it's so neat of Luke to write it this way. Because look, he probably spent about a year in Antioch. But that wasn't what was important to Paul. Paul had a purpose. Paul knew that he was called for a purpose. As we talked about, each one of us has been called. If you're a child of God, you have a calling. And God has given you gifts. And before the foundation of the earth, he created good works for you to do. And he put you, and gave you gifts, called you his name, put you there. And Paul understood his purpose. He understood his gifts, and he understood his calling. So he got right back on the road again. And my guess, though, is during that year that he spent there, he shared with Antioch the things that he's done. Now think about this. If you want to pull up the map, here it is. Aha. Thank you, Kevin. Aha. All right. So they were in Antioch, and if you remember, they went up into Lystra. And this is Galatia and Phrygia. This area right here. And if you remember, they went into Lystra. That's where he started. And what happened in Lystra? Does anyone remember? He picked up Timothy. Now think about this. Timothy's probably standing right next to him, or at least in the congregation of Antioch. But these people never met Timothy. So Paul probably tells them a story about how this boy Timothy, that they met on his first missionary journey, and talking about his mother, and how he got saved, and tell the story of Timothy. And people are probably encouraged hearing about Timothy, and meeting Timothy, and seeing Timothy. And then they go on. And if you recall, that the Holy Spirit wouldn't allow him to share the gospel in Asia. We didn't know why. Acts didn't tell us why. But Paul might have told people in Antioch and shared that incredible story about how the Holy Spirit was working through him. And then they saw a vision in Troas and said of a man telling him to come to Macedonia. He probably shared that vision. Now, how encouraged would you be if a missionary who was here, went out for a couple years, came back and said, God gave me a vision to go into this country, and now look at all the things God did through that vision. We'd be moved, we'd be encouraged, we'd be strengthened through that. But not only that, he picked up a man named Luke, who was from Syria. And he picked up Luke in Troas and took Luke over to Philippi. And if you remember the things that happened to Lydia and Philippi and the jailer and the miracle that took place at midnight and them singing song and all that miraculous, the way the church started Philippi, he probably shared that with the church in Antioch. They were probably encouraged to move. And then I left Luke there. This man Luke, remember Luke? Well, he's at Philippi now strengthening them and teaching them and encouraging them. I want to go back and see him. And then Luke in Philippi, and then he probably told a story about Thessalonica and how he spent a couple weeks there and was chased out of town, chased to Berea, and went from Berea to Athens and sent Timothy and Silas back up to Thessalonica and Philippi. And all those things that we talked about over the last several months, he's probably sharing it with these, and they were probably encouraged. They were probably strengthened hearing this message. And I realized something very important as I was reading that one little half a verse. Last night was so cool. If you were here last night, then you understand what I mean by last night was cool. If you weren't, let me share with you. Because last night, there was only about 11 of us that we got together, and all we did was share praises, share things that God has done in our lives. And I was so encouraged hearing some of the different stories, just here, about how God has worked in our lives through this late year. Dave shared about how much he loves his wife. I know that sounds so, but to me that was just so encouraging. Hear how after, 72 years of marriage, how long have we been together? That he still loves her, and she's still his best friend. And just hearing Crystal talk about the struggle she went through after her pregnancy and things that no one even realized were going through in her heart and her head, and how God used that to strengthen her faith. These things were encouraging to me, and I realized God works in my life every single day. I need to be talking about more. I need to be sharing with you more. We need to create more circumstances for us to share with one another what God is doing. We have 5 minutes during prayer time, and we go, oh, praise. Yeah, my dad is no longer taking cancer treatment. And we move on to the next thing. No, praise God. This is awesome. These things are incredible, how God is working our lives. And we need to, I wrote down Psalm 66, I believe it is in the, I don't have my notes going. I have a bulletin somewhere that has news on it, but it does not matter. But in Psalm 66. Psalm 66, that's up there too. But there's so many verses throughout the Psalms, so many verses throughout the Scripture that talk about how we need to be sharing what God has done. Come and hear all who fear. If you have a fear for God, this reverence for God, we should be moved by what God is doing in others' lives. Think the God of all creation. He has all power, all authority, and he's intervening in individuals' lives. This should encourage each one of us. The way God is intervening in your life is an encouragement to me, and you need to share that with me. The way God is intervening in my life should be an encouragement to you, and I should be sharing these things more. And I realized last night, we don't talk about these things enough. I gave you Acts 14:27, right? Because if you remember, when Paul came back on his first missionary journey, before going on a second one, when he arrived, he gathered the church together and began to report all things that God has done with them, and how they opened the doors Gentiles. All these things. And then that was it. He was going on his first one, and he went on a second, and now he's back from the second, and before he goes on his third, there's no doubt in my mind that he's sharing with him all good things that God has done. So he continues to go out on this missionary journey. So he travels, to bring the map back up. So he travels into Galatia and Phrygia. So if he leaves here and goes in, this is there's no doubt that the first place, well, one of the places that he would have went to as he goes and strengthens these churches would have been Lystra. Now, how cool would that have been when Timothy goes back to Lystra and his mom and his grandmother see him for the first time in 3 years. See, when he left, he was the guy carrying the bags. He comes back and he's preaching. And when he left, he was just a helper and assistant. Now he's one who's he's discipling people. And Timothy has grown so much over these 3 years. Imagine how the people in Lystra, how they would have responded to seeing Timothy's growth. How would you respond? Whether it's the Campbells or other missionaries who sent out, when they come back here and we see their growth, we see the things that God is doing, how does that affect you? Well, we talked about in Sunday school last week in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 3, that we ought to give thanks. We ought to always give thanks to God for you, brethren, as is only fitting, because your faith is greatly enlarged. How cool is that, that Paul was thanking God for others' faith growing? When you see other people growing in faith, do you thank God for it? I know sometimes we're encouraged to it, but are we thanking God? Because so often, it's an encouragement to us when we see other people growing in the faith. Because we're a body here. We're building one another up. If one suffers, all the members suffer. If one is honored, all the members rejoice with it. And we should be rejoicing with one another as we grow and with one another. And I just think this is one of the coolest things, how Timothy coming back to Lystra after 3 years, how that would have been received. How the people in the town, they probably threw a big banquet and had him get up there and share the gospel message and share his testimony. And it probably was just an encouraging thing. But my question to you is, when you see the growth in others, is that encouraging to you? When you see other people being strengthened, when you see other people growing, is that an encouragement to you? And Paul, we go on, go back to Luke, Acts, what Luke was saying. And having spent some time there, he left and passed successively through Galatia region and Phrygia, strengthening all the disciples. Strengthening. And this is what we're going to talk about, this strengthening. Because We see this word four times in Scripture. All four times this word is in the Bible, is in the book of Acts. All four times is in the book of Acts. And I don't know if I part, if you pulled it off or how you want to do this, but strengthening the souls of the disciples, encouraging them to continue in the faith. Let's go to the next one. When they had read it, they rejoiced because of their in, and they were strengthened. Same word, encouragement. They were strengthened. Go to the next one. And he was traveling through Syria and Cilicia, strengthening the churches. Now this word strengthen, it means to build up or to confirm. To confirm. And that, when I read the definition of that, that really hit me, to confirm. Because before you can encourage someone, you have to confirm them. Because we talk about encouragement. It is, look, to help someone continue going forward, pushing something moving forward. Look, there's scary things out there. There's discouraging things out there. There's things that cause anxiety, that cause worries, that cause fears, that cause stress, that discomfortable, discomfortable, uncomfortable, and to cause discomfort. And there's things that we don't like that bother us. But encouragement is to do it anyway. Is to have the courage. Because courage is not having, not lacking fear, being afraid of doing it anyway. So to encourage someone is not to remove what they're afraid of. No, it's to help them do it even though they're afraid. Well, if you're going to try to motivate, inspire, encourage someone to do something, don't you want to make sure that what you're encouraging them to do is the right thing? So first you have to confirm. There has to be a confirmation about whether they're look, you don't want to encourage someone to preach the gospel until you know that they're a believer in Christ. You want to confirm. You don't want to encourage someone to get baptized until you know that they're, you don't want to, you see, there has to be to encourage them, there has to be a confirmation at first. And I realized how important this is, because when I came here to Albion, yeah, I know, kid, it was a long time ago. Oh my goodness. I don't even know how long it is. What was it now? We're going on 7 years. In April, it'll be 7 years. Seven years. Oh my goodness. Getting a 7 year itch. No. But no, it's been 7 years since I've been here. But I remember it was 3 months. At the 3 month point, I just found out my mom had cancer. I was going through all these other things in my life and all. And I wondered, am I supposed to be the pastor to a church of 55 over? I was a 36-year-old who just started in the ministry. Was I supposed to be pastor to an older, smaller church? I always saw myself as a mega church pastor, you know, up there and with the worship team and a big band behind me and a lot, you know. And I wondered, and I began to get discouraged. I began to get doubtful. I wasn't sure. And then Henrietta Tinder invited me over to her house. I'll never forget. She invited me. So, hey, it was 4th of July. Why don't you come over for 4th of July? Okay, great. I went over. 4th of July fell on, I think it was a Thursday that year. I went over to her house on 4th of July. And every Thursday for the next 3 years, till she passed, 4 years, till she passed away, I went to her house. Because she, when I came over, she confirmed it. It was a confirmation. She was, there was not a doubt in my mind, that a doubt in her mind, that I was supposed to be the pastor of Albion Bible Church. She encouraged me because she confirmed that this is where I was supposed to be. It was a, and these believers, there's doubts they had in Galatia. There was doubts they might have had in Phrygia. There was doubts in Lystra, and they weren't sure. The things that Paul taught us 3 years ago, are these real? And Paul came and said, look, God is working in your life here. God is working in your life here. Look at the way that God is doing here. Look, if you do this, watch how God works here. And he showed them things, and it confirmed their salvation. It confirmed that they were part of the church. It's so funny. The confirmation, those so many of you grew up Catholic, and there's a confirmation. Well, what that confirmation is to make sure that person is a believer. And once they confirm your salvation, you say, well, now the Holy Spirit comes behind you, and you're now part of the church. Well, that's what Paul's doing here. This is like, it's not Catholic confirmation, but Paul is confirming that these individuals, yes, the way that God is working, that love that you feel, that love that you see, God is working in you, and it's a confirmation. I cannot doubt my purpose. I can't do it. Because if I try to, I look and see Shirley right now. All right? Every Sunday that Shirley's here, she confirms my call. She does. She comes to me and says, hey, I want to thank you so much for that. I thank God that you're at this church because God has used you. And she says things to me that are so encouraging. And she said, look, my husband's here because he finds you amusing. And Jack, she's finding you funny. And she says, you like my jokes when you come back. You know? And so, but, and me and Jack talk sports too. So in the hallway, we have a connection. No, but she confirms that. And so many times in our lives, people will come to us and they will confirm what our calling is. They'll confirm God working in our lives. They'll confirm that, look, there's probably patients of yours, Karen, who when you talk to, they respond in certain ways. You're like, yeah, God is using me here. God is using me here. And these are beautiful things that we need to open our eyes to and be aware. So as we go into this new year, ladies and gentlemen, understand that you have been called for a purpose. It's not just random. The God of all creation chose you before the foundation of the earth. And he chose you and he gave you gifts. He gave you abilities. He gave you a purpose. And it says that he prepared, we talked about Sunday school, Ephesians 2:10. It says that you are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance. So in advance, way, way back in eternity past, God prepared for good works for you to do. He gives you the ability to do this. He gives you the opportunity to do this. And then when we see God at work, it's confirming that, yeah, God's at work in me. That God's at work in me. And it's a beautiful thing. And we see that Paul understood this. Paul understood his calling. That's why in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, Paul writes, I was bought, that you were bought at a price. Your life is not your own. You were bought at a price. But then later in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, he says that we are one body. God has given a gift for common good. So he called you for a purpose. He bought you for a purpose. Bought you at a price. They gave you gifts for a purpose of edifying one another. And this word, strengthen, it doesn't just mean confirm. It means to build up. To build up. And that's what we're called to do. We're called to build one another up. We're called for the common good. So I don't know what your gifts are. I don't know specifically whether it's giving, or whether it's kindness, whether it's faith, whether it's mercy, whether I don't know where specifically God is using you, but I do know that God has placed you here for a purpose. I do know that God has given you, the Holy Spirit of God has instilled into you a manifestation of his Spirit for the common good. For the common good. I think I should wrap up because everyone's paying attention to him. So, look, as you go into this new year, there's two things we do. We look back and we look forward. So as you look back at the things that God has done. Look back at the ways that God has worked in your life. But as you look forward, look at the ways that God can use you, that God can work in your life, and the things that he's doing now. Because he's called you for a purpose, and our purpose is to fulfill that. So let's be worthy of that calling. That did pretty good. Just 20 minutes. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this calling. Lord, we thank you that you've done a work in us and that you've called us to your name. And that, Father, we thank you for the gifts that you've instilled into us. We pray that your Spirit continues to go before us and continues to work through us, faith through your power. Lord, we thank you. We thank you. So continue to use us. Continue to use us to strengthen one another, to confirm one another, to build one another up. And we pray through it all, you be glorified in us. You allow us to be glorified. We thank you. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
Harry Lewis.